So welcome back to the network theory class. So this is lecture number 10. So in the last class we discussed about what is node and what is a supernode, and related problems also we have solved. Okay, so we will have a quick review about the problems, and one problem which we stopped which was incomplete yesterday, we will look into that. And in today's class, we will continue with that, and also I will give you a little bit introduction to AC circuits. Okay, so AC circuits, so what is this AC circuit and all, we will see. So as we have already dealt with many concepts, so it can be it may be the reduction technique. If we take the reduction technique, so the reduction technique, in that we have used like delta to star or star to delta, delta to star, right? And even the source transformation technique is there, source transformation technique. And we have gone through simple KVL and KCL problems also, and we have seen mesh analysis and super mesh analysis. And also in the last few classes we have gone through nodal analysis and super node analysis. And here what we observe is, in all these discussion and all the circuits what we have considered, so there we had the bunch of resistors, okay, arranged in different networks or different manner. And for each network and few networks, we had only the source, either as DC voltage source, okay, or in some circuits we have seen there is a DC current source, okay. And nowhere in the discussion we have included the inductor and the capacitor. Okay, so whenever you take into consideration about inductor and capacitor, you need to excite them using the AC signal only. Okay, because as you take the frequency component, say for example, if you take X of L, the reactance for inductor, it is simply 2 pi f L. So if you apply a DC source where the frequency will be zero, so then these things will not operate on such conditions. So the inductive reactance for this, it will be zero. That means even though if you use a DC supply for inductor, so it will act like a short circuit. Okay, so that is zero resistance. Similarly, if you consider capacitive reactance, so there it will be the inverse of that, right? So it will act like the open circuit. So these things we will we shall discuss in detail in module number 3, that is transient analysis. Okay, so right now for AC circuits discussion, again we will come across the problems related to star to delta, delta to star, source transformation, and KVL and mesh analysis, super mesh. Okay, so whatever we have discussed so far, that is equally applicable to AC circuits also. Okay, so now considering all these things here, so now if I look into the yesterday's class, so if I just give you the overview, so initially I discussed about the various and definition of the current. So this we have seen. Okay, and while applying the nodal analysis, okay, so what I said, so you need to assume that all the currents as outgoing currents, unless and until the direction of a current source is mentioned, right? So this I have shown it here as an example. You can go through this later once I share the slide here. Okay, And one more condition is, if you find a voltage source, if you find a voltage source like this, what we have. So if that voltage source is coming in between ground and a non-reference node, so then no need to apply KCL here, because always the voltage across that particular node will be equal to the voltage source value what we have mentioned. Okay, so here V1 will be always equal to Vx. So at the most we can apply KCL to V2 only. Okay, so this we have discussed. And coming to the one more set of problems. So this problem I actually wanted to give it as a practice problem. Okay, so now if you consider this here, is the slide is visible to you? The contents are they clear?
Yes, sir.
So if you find any difficulties in reading the contents, so you can inform. Okay, so I am in full screen mode, so please you can unmute and you can ask. Okay, okay, so coming to this problem, so here what is the thing mentioned here? So already we have this circuit given over here. So you have three nodes. So for node VA, so if you note down for node VA, so how many elements are associated with that, or how many branches are associated with that? So three branches are there, right? So here we have 50 ohm resistor, and here we have 2 ampere current source, and again here we have this 10 ohm resistor. And similarly, if you look into the VB node, so again three branches are associated with this. So one 10 ohm resistor, one 50 ohm resistor connected to ground, and 20 ohm resistor, which is, this is 20 ohms. Okay, and here we have plus and minus 8 volts. Okay, and one more node what we have is VC. So again VC is also associated with three branches. Okay, so here the main thing in VC, as you can observe, even though it has got three branches, but one branch is directly connected to the ground through a 20 volt source. So no need to apply KCL. So no need to apply KCL here. Directly you can write VC is equal. The KVL or KCL or any other equations. Okay, so first you observe the circuit like this, hardly it will take some 10-15 seconds. Then you make a note of that observation, then you decide where you can apply KCL. Okay, so as it is already mentioned here, VC is 20, so we can see here the same thing is mentioned. So if you apply KCL to VA, node VA, so I will assume all directions as outgoing current directions. And since this current is already outgoing current, so what we get is this equation. So if you arrange the terms and rewrite it, you will get equation 1. Okay, so how we are defining outgoing current here? 1, 2, 3. Okay, VA minus 8 divided by 50, VA minus VB divided by 10, and another current is 2 amps. No need to write again VA minus VC, already a current is defined. In all the KCL conditions, what we will be doing? We will be defining the current only, right? Or these terms, these ratios are what? These are the current definition, I equal to V by R, right? Okay. So similarly, if you make an approach for VB also, you will get this. Okay, and since VC is already 20, you can use this in equation 1 and 2, and you can solve for VA and VB. So once you do that, then the requirement here is you need to solve for V1 and V2. So if you're solving for V1 and V2, so you should look into the point where V1 is located in the circuit. So it is located between the node A and node B with the resistor of 10 ohms. So this is V1, and if the polarity is already mentioned, so how to define V1? V1 we can define it as VA minus VB. So once you find VA and VB, you can substitute. And similarly, if you want to find V2, where V2 is located, it is located between node B and node C with the value of 20 ohms. And as you can see, it is plus and minus. So if you consider this V2, if you consider just a minute. If you consider this V2 over here again, okay, so this is located. Okay, so this is located in between the nodes B and C. So how to define this V2 now? So you can define V2 as VB minus VC. Already VC we have, so VB you need to find. So that also we have found. So apply the values and evaluate V2. So if you calculate V1 and V2, what we get is these two values, okay? So this is the problem which I wanted to discuss. Okay, so next one is this problem where we stopped at the maybe the one point. So here already we have gone through this problem. So here what we have is regarding this problem, first observation you can make out, what is VB? It is 8 volt. And what is I1? It is VB minus VC divided by 2. So where we have the super node, so this statement is about the super node. So super node is present in between A and D. So you can write the constraint equation. This is the constraint equation. How to write the constraint equation? We have seen in the super node introduction. So you have to subtract the voltage, node voltage, which is at negative polarity, from the node voltage, which is at positive polarity, right? So that should be equated to the voltage value here. So no need to apply KVL here, okay? So don't go for KVL, direct by observation method, you follow that, okay? So if you do that, then you will get that easily, okay? So this one is going to give us VA minus VD equal to 6I1. So this is the constraint equation. And once you identify that there are two nodes which are falling in the super node, so you need to apply KCL to the independent nodes. So we have two independent nodes, B and C, right? So if you apply KCL at B, what you get is VB is equal to 8 volt. Why it is 8 volt? Because this node B, even though it is connected to three branches, but one of the branches is connected to the ground through a direct voltage source. So hence VB will be equal to plus 8 volt. In case if we have the polarity like minus and plus, then we could have written VB equal to minus 8 volt, right? So now it is plus and minus only, so you can write VB is equal to 8 volts. So is that clear? So if you have any questions till here, you can ask. Okay, so you can unmute yourself if you are willing to ask any question. Otherwise, I will continue. Okay. So next, where we have another independent node, we have at node C. So here again it is connected to three branches. So here in the node C you find that one branch is there where current is already defined. So except this branch, we assume all other branch currents as outgoing currents. Okay. So if you apply KCL now, what you will get? You will be getting VC minus VB divided by 2 plus VC minus VD divided by 2 equal to 4. This is the incoming current. These two are the outgoing currents. Okay. So using the value of VB, so what you get is this equation. And similarly, if you continue the constraint equation, if you continue the constraint equation over here, so what we have is VA minus VD equal to 6I1. So if you substitute what is I1 here, so you will get this. What is I1? It is VB minus VC. So this is VB minus VC divided by 2. Okay. So if you calculate and rearrange the things, you will be getting this equation. So we have got two equations already. Okay. Now coming to the super node. So how should be the approach here in the super node? So first we have to remove the voltage source, and you have to club the nodes where that voltage source was present. So it was present in between A and D, right? So remaining part of the circuit, you keep it as it is, right? So we are interested in these points. So from node A, how many branches were there from node A? If you remove the voltage source, 2 branches, 2 ohms and 2 ohms, they are meeting node B and node ground. Okay. And node D, it was associated with ground node and node C. So here again, out of 4 branches, you find that one is a current source, which is the incoming. Others will be assumed as outgoing currents. So come to node A. You need to write with respect to node A only now. So VA minus VB divided by 2, then VA divided by 2, then plus VD minus VC divided by 2 equal to 3VC. So that you have to write. Okay. So is that clear now to everyone? So if you consider this, okay. So here, once you continue, so you will be getting this equation. So in this equation, as you can see, you have this terms coming. And once you rewrite and arrange the things, you will be getting equation number 3. So now if you solve equation 1, 2 and 3 in terms of VA, VB and VD, VA, VB and VD, so what we get is these values. Okay. And what was asked in the question, you have to solve for VC and VD, right? Okay. So if you consider the entire equation, we will be solving in terms of not this one, VA, VC and VD. Okay. So there are 3 terms, but they are not in what you say, a linear manner. We have A, C and D. So you need to use equation 1, 2 and 3 in the calculator and solve it for 3 unknowns. So you will be getting this answer. Okay. So fine. Is that clear now? So if you have any questions, you may ask. So once this is completed, next I will be going to the AC circuit analysis. If you have any questions, please ask. Please proceed. Okay, so I will be moving to the next topic now, that is sinusoidal steady state analysis. So for this one, so I prefer to use the textbook that is reference text 3, okay, Matthew Sedko and Alexander, that is Fundamentals of Electric Circuits by Alexander. So this textbook I have already shared. So you can go through chapter number 9 here, chapter number 9 for this. Okay. So it is about the steady state analysis, sinusoidal steady state analysis. Okay. So now if you go through this steady state analysis before that, so right now we are using AC supplies in our homes, right? But earlier, if you go back way back to around 1800 and all there, so they were using the DC supply only. So one researcher found that the AC supply is more convenient and more feasible also, so he introduced that. Okay. And there was a if you may not believe that there was a court case regarding this issue, and possibly AC circuit came out to be as a winner. So hence we are using this AC circuit in our home and everywhere appliances. Okay. So that story is just for your reference. Okay. So you can go through that. It is there in the textbook anyway. Now the main requirement in our network theory is, so until till now we have seen the excitation, something like I might have written like 10 volts, and we had only the resistive networks, right? So now if I introduce the capacitor and inductor, then how to determine the V of T and I of T here? So earlier we used to find something like only V and I. Now it is something like V of T and I of T in time domain. So this is called as time domain, because we will be calculating a parameter with respect to time, how it varies. It may be a voltage or it can be a current also. Okay. So now if you look into the any sinusoidal signal, so you know the representation here, it will be like this. Okay. So there are two signals which have been shown, that is V1 and V2. So we know already how to define these V1 and V2. So there is a there are some conventions. If you use like small V1, they are used for AC signals only. So if you use capital V, that is not for AC signal. Okay. So this is how you have to differentiate. So how this V1 and V2 are defined now? They are defined like capital V to the M sine omega T. So where Vm is the amplitude. So this amplitude, what is the maximum amplitude here? And omega T, so this omega T, it represents what? It represents the angular frequency. Okay. And usually it is measured in radians per second. Okay. So if you don't want to measure in radians per second, instead of omega T, you have to just use T, that will be in terms of seconds. Okay. And now the same thing is elaborated here. You can see here what is V of T. It is defined as Vm sine omega T plus phi, where Vm is what? It is the amplitude of the sinusoid, omega is the angular frequency, and phase, phi is the phase. So phase means it can start like this one signal or another signal, it may start somewhere like this. Okay. So there exists one more phase difference, or some signals may start like this also. Okay. So there are different phase values what you can observe, okay, but we are not interested in this. So first you should understand these parameters: amplitude, angular frequency and phase. Usually phase is very rare in our discussions, okay. So we are almost limited to Vm sin omega t only, or Vm cos omega t also, okay. So here is an example how we can identify a periodic function and differentiate between the two different signals having two different phases, okay. So just go through this anyway. So now if I look, take an example, and before I take an example here, so let me give you few trigonometric relations. So few trigonometric relations you need to keep in your mind. Just make a note of that, those trigonometric relations. You can write here a note. Okay, so totally four trigonometric relations you need to remember. First one is minus sine omega t is equal to sine omega t plus or minus 180 degree. That means if you have a signal defined in the negative, so you can convert it into a positive signal also. So it will simplify the things, that's all. Okay, so then second one is similarly minus cos omega t will be equal to cos of omega t plus or minus 180. Okay, third one is minus or plus sin omega t, it can be converted into cos omega t plus or minus 90. That means if you have minus sin omega t, you can convert it into a cosine signal, or if you have a sine signal also, that can be converted into a cosine signal. So in the same way, if you consider for another condition, that is plus and minus cos omega t, so this can be converted into a sine signal, sinusoid, sine of omega t plus or minus 90. Okay, so keep these things in your mind or make a note of these things. So we will be using these things. Okay, now if you consider this example here, what is mentioned, this example number one. So it is given a sinusoid with the value 5 sin 4 pi t minus 60 degree. Calculate its amplitude, phase, angular frequency, period and frequency. Okay, so how to do that? So if you compare this with something like Vm sin omega t plus or minus 5. So we find that this is the amplitude here, that is 5, and omega t is equal to 4 pi t, what is mentioned here. And what is omega? Omega is 2 pi f equal to 4 pi. So if you take the frequency, it turns out to be 2 hertz. Okay, and the period means t is equal to 1 by f, so that will be 0.5 seconds. Okay, and what is the phase here? The phase here is minus 60. Okay, so these are the very basic identities or basic platforms you need to understand. Okay, so these things may not be asked in the examination, but if you know these things perfectly, the application wise it will be easy. Okay, similarly if you go through this example, what is being asked here, you are asked to find the phase angle. Now the phase angle between two signals I1 and I2, and also you have to comment whether I1 leads or I2 lags. So if you consider all these things into account, we see that I1 is a negative signal, minus 4 sign is there. So this can be converted into a positive either by using this relation or by using this relation. Anyone you can use. Okay. So here it is mentioned that it is being converted into a cosine signal. So they come out with these values. Okay. So I hope you are getting this. And once it is converted, it is being shown that I1 leads I2 by 155 degrees. Okay. It is a simple calculation, nothing there. Then comes this very important phenomenon here, that is, whatever we discussed till now, as I told earlier, so it was related to a resistive network, as I mentioned. Okay. So now if you consider the frequency domain and time domain, so in frequency domain we come across another thing that is called as a phasor, a phase of the signal. How to define that? So that can be defined either in rectangular form or in the polar form or in the exponential form. Okay, so how to do that? Rectangular form, this is expressed as like a complex number, and usually it is like x plus jy. So in the calculator you should use it as z equal to x plus yi. Okay, so where to use it? So in the calculator you have to go to the mode. If you press mode, you will get second one as complex. Is that visible to you, the calculator?
Okay,
so you will be getting second option as complex. So once you press 2, you will get the complex mode. Okay, so there if you are using this 991 ms, okay, so if you go to that plus and minus, okay, plus and minus operators, so there it is mentioned as this one r comma at an angle theta. Okay, then one more thing is mentioned like a plus bi. Okay, so this you can use it with the operator shift also. Okay, say for example, if I want to type 2 plus j2 in calculator, how it is mentioned? 2 plus 2i. You have to go to complex mode. Make sure that you are in complex mode. Okay, you have to press 2 plus 2 and shift of I, so that I is okay, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so there
was a
network problem, I guess. Okay, fine. Okay, so if you have these things, you can use it in the calculator, fine. So similarly, you can also use the exponential form, but most of the times we will be using these two forms. Okay, so as we go ahead, you will get familiar to this. No need to worry. So if you have already used this, then it is good anyway. Say for example, now if I ask you to evaluate these things here, this one and this one. So how to do it in the calculator? So you have to go to the complex mode. Okay, so there you can type, 5 plus 2i. So make sure that you are using these brackets, not this one, this bracket. And again in the bracket, -1 plus 4i, and minus in the bracket you can write 5 at an angle 60. So once you take the answer will be, by default, it will be in the rectangular form. Okay, so you will be getting only -15.5 as an answer. Then you have to, if you want to see the imaginary part, you have to press shift equal to, so that you will get something like 13.67i. okay, so this you have to practice. Okay, so if you have any difficulties in using the calculator, so please practice this. So I am telling each thing step by step. Okay, and in these cases, these kind of cases, if you consider, so here what you can do is you can use the numerator part first and take the answer as it is, then take the denominator part, divide it, you will get one answer, then add it to this, so that you will be getting this answer. So please practice these two very small activities. Okay, because I have mentioned the answer also here, so please cross verify the things. Okay, so remember, in the calculator you will be getting, by default you will be getting the answer in rectangular form. So if I want to convert it into polar form, what you can do is you can just press answer, ANS, and you can use shift, answer followed by shift followed by this plus button. So there you have this notation, that is R at an angle theta. Okay, so once you use this, you will be getting the answers in polar form. Okay, so you can cross verify that anyway. Okay, so let me check whether it is recording or no. Okay, it's fine. So now if you go to the next thing, so you should be aware of these mathematical operations. Okay, so please go through these things. I hope, I think you might have studied in your M1 and M2 courses, even though you need to just come across this and solve few problems. Okay, so please go through these addition, subtraction and all. Okay, so at the most it will be helpful at the end of the calculation in the program, in the problem. Okay, so next, this is a very important part here. So if you are looking for converting a sinusoid to and from the time domain to phasor domain, so how to do that? So see, what is the necessary to do this? Because see here, if I mention a circuit having something like Vm cos omega t plus phi as an input, and resistor, capacitor, inductor, if everything is there, and if I ask you to calculate the current through this, then everywhere you need to use this Vm cos omega t plus phi. So instead of that, it can be converted into a simple form, that is V is equal to Vm at an angle theta. So this will be very convenient to use. Okay, so once we take up the problems, you will come to know anyway. Okay, so now coming to the next requirement, so I will give you one more example here. So if I ask you to convert the following sinusoid signals to phasor form, so either phasor form or you may use polar form also, polar or means rectangular, we will be using any one of this, either polar or rectangular. Okay, so how to do that? So we know already this signal, if you consider for instance, it is 6 cos 50 t minus 40. So what if you compare this with vm cos omega t minus 5, so what we will be getting, vm equal to 6 and 5 is equal to minus 40. Phi or theta can be anything. Okay, so this I can express in polar form as 6 at an angle minus 40. So if I ask you to convert it into rectangular form, so how to do that? So this one you can convert it into using the calculator in complex mode. So you can type 6 shift. So you can press shift, and here above this, here you find an angle, so there you can use as minus 40, so it should look like this. And if you press equal, you will be getting like 4.59, and then if you press shift equal, you will be getting minus 3.85 i. okay, so this will be something like 4.8 minus 4.5 minus 3.8 i. okay, so this you have to practice anyhow. Okay, second example. So here what we can do in the second example, it is a negative signal, so convert it into either a positive cosine or positive sine. Okay, so here you should be smart here. So if the source is defined in cos, usually we consider the cosine term because it will be simple to evaluate. So preferably this is preferred to convert any signal, sine, negative sine or positive sine, into positive cosine. So how it is done? So we know that minus of sine A is cos A plus 90. So what is the value here? 50. 50 plus 90 you have to do. So what you will be getting is 140. That's all. Okay, so it will be very simple now, right? So here you find that amplitude will, magnitude of the amplitude will remain same, only the phase will change. Okay, so I hope you are getting these things. So you should be aware of these trigonometric relations, these four trigonometric relations. Okay, you make a note of this wherever you sit, you paste these things daily, you have to see these equations. Okay, so it should be in your mind. And in the examination, what you can do, you can just reproduce this in the rough page, last page, you can make a note of that, and if it is necessary you can use it. Okay, so similarly, if I go to the one more example here, so what is asked? So you have to transform the sinusoid to corresponding phasors. Okay, so it is a reverse one. The phasor value is given to you, you have to get the corresponding, this is A, this is B, corresponding sinusoid value you have to get. So amplitude is 10 cos omega t. So why it is 210? 180 is added here. It is in minus, so it is taken as positive. Okay, otherwise if you want to keep it in minus, you have to get the, instead of cos, you have to define it in terms of sine. Okay, and similarly now this is given, so what to do? So the thing is, the steps are given, so you are not doing this. Since you have the calculator, simply you are converting a rectangular form into a polar form using the functions available in the calculator. So if you do that, you will get 13 at an angle 22.62, right? So this you can define it as 13 as the amplitude, 22.62 as the phase. So we know, we don't know about omega value here. Okay, so we can keep it as it is. Okay, so is that clear to everyone? So if you have any questions, you may ask. Okay, fine. This is a very important here. What is the difference between V of t and capital V? So as I told, V of t is the instantaneous or time domain representation. So if I write a signal like V of t equal to something like Vx cos omega t plus or minus phi. So this V of t is the instantaneous value and it is in time domain. So how to define it in frequency domain? So we have to write this in frequency domain as Vx at an angle phi. Okay, so this is the main difference here. Okay, and if you make a one note here, so that is already taken. Phasor analysis applies only when frequency is constant, right? When it is applied to two or more sinusoid signals, only if they have the same frequency. So this is a very key note here. So we have to be aware of this. Okay. Then the same thing is represented here for voltage. So instead of voltage, if you have current, this is same as I is equal to I of phi. Okay, fine. So dv by dt, how we can do that? J omega of v in phasor form. This is time domain, this is frequency domain. Okay, and if you have the integration, you can take it as v divided by j omega. Okay, these are the key points. We are not interested in these derivations because it is a mathematical part. Okay, just remember this. Okay, that's all. Then this figure indicates a phasor relationship for the various circuit elements. So if you find the resistor, so in a resistor always current and voltage, they vary linearly, so there will not be any phase difference. But whereas in inductor and capacitor, in inductor voltage always leads the current by some angle, and in capacitor it is reverse. Current leads the voltage by some angle. Okay, so considering this is only for reference, this is a picture here. Okay, but here you should be aware of how to define the voltage and current for the elements. So it is also shown here. So we are aware of the Ohm's law, V equal to IR. So this is in time domain. In frequency domain, how it is written? Capital V equal to capital I into R. And similarly in time domain, for inductor voltage is defined as V is equal to L into di by dt. So V is replaced with capital V here and L is kept as it is. What is dv by dt or di by dt? So this one, if di by dt is there, you have to write j omega I. So it is j omega I here. Okay, similarly for capacitor also, the time domain and the frequency domain values. Okay, and now if you come to this phasor relationship for the circuit elements, the same thing what we discussed just now has been shown there. So if you go in detail about these things, so how we can write these things? So I can also elaborate. See here, for resistor I may write this as how we have got in terms of, I can write the current, what is I? I of R, current through the resistor in time domain, it is something like Im cos omega t plus phi. It can be cos signal or sine signal. The same thing if I want to define what is I here. So I will be Im at an angle phi. Similarly, if you have voltage across the resistor, just replace I by V. I by capital V here, capital I by capital V, same thing here. Okay. Similarly for the inductor and capacitor also. Okay. So this you have to remember for the calculation purpose. Okay. So this one with respect to, okay, that is fine. See, now if I ask you or if I give you a very small problem here, so something like, just make a note here, example, can take the example. Okay, if the example is like this, if V of t is equal to 12 cos 60t plus 45, okay, volts is applied, if it is applied to an inductor of 0.1 henry, then you are asked to find steady state current through inductor. Okay, so how to imagine this circuit? So we can have, we can assume that there is a AC source of V of t connected to an inductor. Okay, if this is V of t, then we know current through this entire circuit will be I of t, and what is L? It is 0.1 henry. So it is very difficult to use these definitions. So if I use V of t 12 cos 60 t plus 45, and also inductor value as 0.1 henry. So what I will do is, I can convert this into the phasor value. So this is in time domain. I can convert it into frequency domain. So if you convert this into frequency domain, so what we will be getting here? So just for your reference, I will write V of f. I can write it as 12 at an angle 45 degrees. Okay. So this I can use it here, the supply value as 12 at an angle 45 degree. So this will be very simple to calculate rather than in this domain. And similarly, the inductor, this can be converted into what now? This can be converted into equivalent impedance. So how to do that? We know what is X of L. It is 2 pi F L. So comparing this equation, so what we get, you can compare here, so that what you will be getting is, we find that omega is 60 t in the above equation. So if you define this omega as 60 t, what is omega? It is 2 pi f. So if you take this, if you equate this, so you find that the omega value is equal to 60. Omega is 2 pi f equal to 60. So if you want to find the equivalent value, so frequency, in frequency domain, it will be 60 divided by 2 pi. So if you check out this, okay, then you can get the value of the equivalent value of the inductor. So equivalent value, what you will be getting? So equivalent value of the inductor will turn out to be as J6 ohms. Okay. So how this can be obtained now? J6 ohms. So here I have shown you already J omega Li. So this one. Okay. So you can use the calculator and you can convert that into the equivalent value. Okay. So how to get this into this point? L is equal to J6 ohms. So to do that, what I have to do is, so we know L is can be defined as J omega L. Okay. So we want in frequency domain, in time domain, we have this. So J multiplied by omega is how much? It is 60. And L is how much? It is given as 0.1. So if you multiply this, you will be getting J6 ohms. Okay. So this is how we can calculate the L value. And if you want to calculate the total current, so total current can be calculated in frequency domain as I equal to V by R. So V by impedance. What is the impedance? Voltage through the inductor in frequency domain and impedance of the inductor. So that turns out to be the voltage is 12 at an angle 45 divided by J6 you can use, or you can also use 12 at an angle 45. J6, if you convert it into polar form, you will be getting 6 and at an angle 90. So this turns out to be 2 at an angle minus 45 amps. Okay, so this is very important here. So that is this step. If you have a capacitor, so we'll see that in the next example here. So if you have a capacitor, as it is quoted here, V of t 6 cos 100 t minus 30 is applied to 50 microfarad capacitor. That means you have a circuit where you have V of t and you have capacitor only. But capacitor is mentioned as 50 microfarad. So this you have to convert it into a frequency domain value. How to do that? So use this equation, right? So that is, for inductor we used J omega L, for capacitor you have to use 1 divided by J omega C. So X of C is 1 divided by J omega C. And what are the values here? So the values are omega is 100 and C is 50 micro, 50 into 10 to the power minus 6. So calculate that, you will be getting the value of X of C. And similarly, what will be the value here? 6 at an angle minus 30. So divide that, you will get the current through the capacitor also. Okay, so that they have given it in the form of time domain again. Okay, so practice this also. Fine. Now if you look into the impedance and admittance relations, so impedance, how we define for a resistor? So we take it in the form of ohms. Z is equal to V by with R plus JX form. So there will not be any imaginary part in the resistance. But if you consider the capacitor and inductor, so you can define the real part and imaginary part. So X is the imaginary part and R is the real part. Okay. So if you consider the impedance and admittance will be 1 over Z. So if the current is for admittance, it will be the admittance in terms of current and voltage, it will be I by V. If you consider the relation V equal to IR, okay. So this R, if I replace with Z impedance, so that will be V by I. If I define Z is equal to as an admittance, so this will be I by V. Okay. So if you consider this one, Y will be equal to I by V. Okay. So they are the simple relations. And here is the table which you can use if you want to calculate the admittance and impedance. So for earlier problem, we have used this equation. And second problem, we have to use this equation. Okay. And this is very important here, this relation. Please make a note of this 3-star. Okay. So here you can see that if you are using an inductor, so with the DC supply, what will happen to omega component? It is 2 pi f. If frequency is zero, then the impedance will be zero. So zero impedance or zero resistance, it is indicated by what? Short circuit. But if you have some frequency, some finite frequency or higher frequency, it will show some impedance. So that means you can use it as a open circuit. Okay. Then similarly, if you apply for the capacitor, it will be in reverse way. Okay. Then what we do is, after applying, after converting the time domain into frequency domain or vice versa, so we can use this for using or evaluating a circuit using the either KCL, KVL, star delta or source transformation. Everywhere we can use these things. Okay. So one practice problem for you, we can just make a note of this right now, and you have to solve for both V of T and I of T. So everyone must do this exercise. So Monday or in the next class, we will discuss that. Okay. And okay. So with this, we will conclude the session here. So if you have any questions to be asked, you can ask, please. And let me take the attendance. Don't exit now. I will be sharing this slide. You can use this for reference. Okay. Yes, if you have any questions, you may ask, please.